And welcome back, everyone. Once again, I'm Mark Johnston, your host for VID5, brought to you by our friends at Laurentian Bank Securities. And we are at the top of the hour with our last session of the day. And we have the great privilege and some wonderful news to share with our final featured company here. We're with Fury Gold Mines, and we have Michael Hendrickson, who is the Senior Vice President of Exploration. Michael, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for having us, or me.
Absolutely. I do know off the top we have some pretty special news. I want to get to that in just a moment, but a little bit of housekeeping to offer our audience. Once again, as we wind down the day, your questions are very welcome in the Q&A column. We'll have a presentation from Michael on where Fury Gold Mines is today and what's about in the news, because today was a very special day. So let me at that point, Michael, say a huge congratulations on the transaction today. I'm going to leave that to you to describe, but the whole team here at VID Conferences wants to congratulate you.
Yeah, thanks very much. We're very happy to have completed that as part of our sort of vision for the future.
Very good. Very good. Well, if I could ask you to maybe offer a little bit of insight to our audience for those who may not know, and then I'll leave it to you to move on into our presentation as well.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, obviously, we will be making some more some forward-looking statements here, so you'll have to bear with us on that. And I'll take that as read. But ultimately, you know, we just entered into an agreement with Dolly Varden Silver where we're basically selling our Homestake Ridge project to them. It allows us to very much focus in on Quebec, but also allows us to have 40% of the resultant company, have the upside, and put some cash into our treasury, which is also very important. So for us, it's a bit of a transformative transaction in that we have the upside of the Homestake Ridge. We're combining assets that have a fantastic synergy together with the Dolly Varden deposits and, of course, our own Homestake Ridge deposit. And we really feel that it's positioning that part of the Golden Triangle to really move ahead in a synergistic way. And ultimately, I think, for the benefit of both companies moving forward and potentially to see, you know, what can happen into the future, whether it be a transaction or a mine build or what have you. But by having these two assets together, we just see that as the most accretive thing we could have possibly done for our shareholders. At the same time, things are going really well for us in Quebec at Eau Claire. You know, getting into some new mineralization on the western side of the deposit, really demonstrating that it's going to be able to be expanded out in that direction. And then, of course, at Committee Bay, we've just released a fantastic drill hole, nearly 14 grams per ton over 10 meters at our Three Bluffs deposit. We really see a very strong potential for resource expansion there. And ultimately, there are some pending results, both from Eau Claire and Committee Bay, that we're eagerly awaiting for the future. So at the end of the day, you know, things are firing on all cylinders for us. We're getting great drill results out of Quebec and Nunavut. And of course, you know, we've pulled off this transaction that I feel is going to be very accretive for all of our shareholders. So let's get into our portfolio. You know, obviously, you can see we're at Eau Claire. It's been our primary focus for the last year. We're currently just shy of about 1.3 million ounces at Eau Claire at very strong grades. But ultimately, you know, we believe this gets a lot bigger. And our job is to get out there with the drill bit and demonstrate that. And I certainly feel like our last round of results has done exactly that. At the same time, in Quebec, we have the Éléonore South joint venture, where we're partnered with Newmont Mining and, of course, Azimut Exploration. We are the operator. We see a fantastic upside there and really great exploration to be done on things that haven't ever been looked at before. So we very much look forward to doing that. Up in Nunavut, Committee Bay, 300-kilometer-long greenstone belt. What an opportunity. I mean, we're unabashed when we say, listen, we're here to hunt for elephants. This is elephant country. We're out to find 5+ million ounces at high grade. And certainly that, I think our last result from the Three Bluffs deposit demonstrates that, you know, that is absolutely in the cards moving forward. And then, of course, we've talked about our Homestake Ridge transaction where we're really combining that deposit with the Dolly Varden assets. And really, you know, putting that part of the Golden Triangle into a place where, you know, ultimately shareholders from both companies, you know, can really enjoy the fruits of that synergistic combination. So with that, In terms of a management team, Tim Clark's unable to be with us here today, but he's joined us. He's got an extremely strong banking background, which I think is going to be very important for our company moving forward. Myself, I come from Newmont Mining by training, from the exploration side, Brian Atkinson, very well-rounded technical team. And then, we're just very well supported in general by Lindsay and Salisha, as well as our CFO and VP Investor Relations. And then, of course, strong board to navigate all the waters we need to navigate. So really, what was this Homestake Ridge transaction? We're selling this deposit to Dolly Varden. It's valued at about $50 million, the transaction. And really, this consolidation of the two adjacent projects just allows the ability to have more optionality in terms of development, operating synergies, exploration opportunities. And I think that's really important. When you look at this land package now, there's a 15-kilometer strike length, 163 square kilometers available to explore. I know from talking with the Dolly Varden team that there's a lot of very good targets that they have. We feel the same, of course, at the Homestake Ridge. And ultimately, for us to have them put together and to have a very strong team at Dolly Varden drive this forward, we feel is the absolute right move to make as a company. Certainly, as I've said, we acquire roughly 40% of their of the company of Dolly Varden through the issuance of 76 million shares, and then there's a $5 million cash consideration as well. We will have two board seats on there. We are partners with Dolly. That's how we really view this, and I know that they do as well. So we really look forward to working with the Dolly Varden team, and ultimately, we're just waiting on their shareholder vote. To be held in February of 2022 to finalize all of this. So, when we look at this, we just see a fantastic opportunity to sort of go beyond the Homestake Ridge project economics that are on the right-hand side of the slide to build something, much more significant. And I think something that is going to be eyed by a lot of producers in truth. So, really looking forward to the shareholder vote from Dolly Varden, and looking forward to this this portion of the Golden Triangle getting the attention it deserves. Ultimately, anything that we do, of course, has to have a very strong ESG component, and it's the core of our business at the end of the day. We know that we need to be operating at a very high level on all of these positions, whether it be environment or social or governance. We want to obviously partner with each of the communities that we're working within, be it the Kitikmeot Inuit Association or the Nisga'a First Nation or the East Main Cree, and I just want this to be very clear, that this is at the core of our values and something that we absolutely, consider first priority in the building of our company. So with that, what I think we'll do now is we'll start talking a little bit more about Eau Claire. Eau Claire, located in the James Bay region of Quebec, obviously blessed by infrastructure, having Hydro-Québec there with their roads and power network is a wonderful situation to be in. And I think ultimately, from the potential of building a mine in the future, this is the kind of place you want to be. We're located approximately 57 kilometers south of the Éléonore mine held by Newmont. You can see the Éléonore South joint venture just to the south of the Éléonore mine, and we're very happy to be operating in this environment. Super easy to operate in, allows exploration to occur 12 months a year, and ultimately a place that we call home now. This is where we want to be, and we want to focus in on making Eau Claire, an asset that's going to be coveted by other parties moving forward. This is the land position. We're looking at over 50,000 hectares here. And obviously, on the left-hand side of that slide, you see the red rectangle. That's the Eau Claire deposit trend. That's where we've been focusing thus far. But I just want to show the bigger picture here, because all these beautiful red polygons that you see are target areas for us that realistically have seen very little way of work in the way of exploration. The bottom part of the image there is the Kennard deformation zone. This is what really is the locus and the focus of mineralization in this part of the world. And we've got 30 kilometers of strike length to explore. There has been a wonderful discovery made by our predecessors at Percy Val that we plan to expand upon. And we will go into a little bit more detail about that. But, you know, just extending that out into the eastern part of our land package is going to be very important, as well as exploring some of the other opportunities that we see to the north of Eau Claire itself. So, you know, we truly believe that there is a second deposit to be found here in this land package, and that's what we're going to get after here in 2022. So, you know, when we got into Eau Claire, you know, the question is, well, does it get bigger? And so what you see here is you basically see a snapshot in time upon the acquisition of the Eau Claire deposit by Fury Gold Mines. And obviously, the hotter the color that you see here, you know, the higher the grade of mineralization. And you can see the deposits very clearly defined. But ultimately, for us, the key was that it was defined by the limits of drilling. You know, we came out here and we said, okay, well, let's drill some extension holes. What's going to happen? You know, so 6 meters of 11 grams or 7 meters of 23 grams. Obviously, this deposit gets bigger. Recently, we've been out on the left-hand side of the image, on the western side of the deposit. All of a sudden, we're hitting high grade at fairly shallow levels in a geometry that we feel that we can follow for at least a kilometer. You know, that's a big statement, but obviously something that we feel can be very accretive moving forward. So that's the near deposit extensions that we definitely are going to chase into the future. But also, you know, when we first acquired this asset, we said to ourselves, we need to step out and really show that it's much more than meets the eye. And so we went out to the right at target A and target B. And we took a 700 meter step out, our very first drill hole, out into the unknown. And lo and behold, we hit the structure exactly where we thought we would. We knew that the mineralization looked exactly the same as what you see in the resource itself at Eau Claire. And we got some good hits, you know, 15 gram rock over a meter. You know, that's definitely going to be a mineable width, in my opinion. You know, same meter and a half of 8.3 and just seven holes out way into the distance. Clearly more drilling needs to be done. There's also a second structure in the back called Snake Lake. These are two parallel structures and Snake Lake has proven to be very interesting to us so far. We've got a lot of results pending, but you know, when we stepped about 800 meters from underneath the historical drilling, you know, we had a half a meter and 94 grams, I mean, multi-ounce material. And we just said to ourselves, okay, we've got to explore this. You know, what a wonderful opportunity to have two structures so close to one another, you know, to really build out our resource base moving forward. So, you know, when I look at this at the end of the day, I just see growth in front of me. And I see the you know, some fantastic opportunities to just keep drilling on geometries that we're truly starting to understand now. So from my point of view, what you see here on this slide is just pure expansion of our resource base. And you can expect us to do that in 2022 moving forward, no question about it. Now, to show you a little bit more about particularly the fold hinge target out on the western side, on the left-hand side of this image, you can see this blue unit wrapping around. And that blue unit is an anticline. It's just a nice folded piece of sedimentary or volcanic stratigraphy, and it's plunging off to the west. And we've started to be able to follow this, and that is a huge deal for us. It's a very favorable position for mineralization in that fold hinge. We've hit it now successfully on our first four drill holes. We're hitting multiple stacked zones of veining, very much like you see within the resource envelope itself, highlighted by the red polygon here. And for us, we're drilling currently underneath the resource that's been defined to date. And for us, that's a big deal. We just view that as something we absolutely must follow up on, and something that ultimately, you know, gives us confidence that we're going to build this resource out. our vision as a group of explorationists is to get this resource over 2 million ounces. And we certainly feel that, you know, the drilling we've done thus far allows us to put that in our minds, you know, keep drilling to the west, keep drilling to the east, drill along Snake Lake, make this happen, you know, show the good results that we've had to the market, demonstrate that this resource is going to get a lot bigger in the future. Now, here what you can see is some of these recent intercepts on the fold hinge target on the western side of the deposit. And you can see some red shapes on the image on the left. That is the resource that is being defined to date. And you can see we've stepped underneath that, and all of a sudden we're hitting additional mineralization that had never been drill tested before. And in fact, you know, one of the things that we as a group of explorationists really thought was important here is that the deposit horizon we felt had never really been tested. On the western side of the deposit, you're dealing with a unit that sort of sits above where the bulk of the resource is hosted. And we said, we got to drill underneath this and see what happens. And that's where we got into sort of more iron-rich volcanic stratigraphy that's certainly hosting gold mineralization. And, you know, now that we've hit 3 meters of, you know, plus 9 grams to us, we just continue to follow that. Simple. You know, so when we look at this, next plan is to test the next 500 meters of that geometry. But, you know, in my mind, you know, we've got to step out a kilometer along the way. And that if we are successful in continuing to get intercepts like that, you know, I really believe that's going to be highly accretive to the resource base moving forward. Now, then, you know, we've talked a lot about what's in tight to the Eau Claire deposit, but now we're going to step 14 kilometers to the east to Percy Val. And this was part, I remember it very well going on the due diligence visit when we were taking this asset over. And we went out to Percy Val, and I asked about the discovery story, because you take a look at this. I mean, 93 meters of plus 2 grams right from surface, you know, 18 meters of plus 3 grams. A lot of good high grade intervals in there. You know, at depth, you see 2 meters of nearly 8.5 grams. We see this as something that's going to be accretive. We see Percy Val as just the start. We believe it's got a good down plunge extension that hasn't been tested. You can see that, and the colored shape in the background is magnetics. And high magnetics is where the gold mineralization is hosted. So for us, when we look at this, we say, listen, you know, clearly we've got to follow this down plunge. We've got to keep drilling at Percy Val. We want to know more about how big this can become. As you step even 500 meters over to the east, there's an untested parallel fold hinge. You know, we looked at all of this, we looked at how early the discovery is here, and we said to ourselves, let's do some exploration this summer. Let's get a really solid geochemical picture over a 7 kilometer strike length so that we can really understand, you know, where gold mineralization is on those structures. And so those results from the geochemistry are coming in now. We're just starting to get those results. I fully anticipate a lot of targets to fall out of that beyond just, you know, drilling the extensions of what's been found to date or this untested parallel fold hinge. So when we look at this and we say, okay, do you have a second discovery on the property package? The answer is yes to me. You know, I just see this as something that made me want to commit to getting into this asset. And Percy Val, I think, is going to be something that is going to play a big part of our future over the next several years as we continue to drill along this corridor that we defined at approximately 7 kilometers in length. Expect us to have a lot of news out of Percy Val, not only the geochemistry, but also geophysical targeting beyond the magnetics. You know, fortuitously for us, you know, there's going to be a very clear chargeability signature from an IP survey. Our plan is to fingerprint that at the mineralization that we found, that's been found at Percy Val already, use it in conjunction with the geochemistry results that are coming in, and really set up a fantastic drill program for 2022 along that corridor. So again, you know, look to us to make a second discovery, to expand upon this one, you know, that we're very excited about. All right. Now what we're going to do is we're going to move on to the Éléonore South joint venture. Obviously we're just 11 kilometers to the south of the Éléonore mine, operated by Newmont. And there's been a lot of work that's occurred on this joint venture through time. It's a big land position. We've got nearly 15,000 hectares here. Again, we're the operator. We basically have an equal percentage with Newmont at about 38%. Azimut Exploration holds the bulk or the remainder of it at 24%. And because we're the operator and we manage the joint venture, this puts us in a really important position in terms of driving, of course, with our partners, the exploration ideas. And so historically, when we got into this, we saw the Chichu deposit on just to the north of the joint venture. And look, it's a solid deposit. It clearly straddles the boundary between their land position and the joint venture land position. You can see that on that little inset in terms of the grade shell model, and a lot of drilling's being done on that deposit extension, to the south of the Sirios ground. However, when we looked at it from just a first principles standpoint, let's just get away from that for a moment and take a look at what we've got. What you see here, all these colored dots, is gold in tills. And you can see in the central portion of the property a 5.5 kilometer long geochemical anomaly, with very robust values for tills. Anything in pink's sort of a quarter gram gold and above. And we said to ourselves, nobody's drilled here. We absolutely need to get after that. There's multiple structures that cross it. And, to my mind, we've done a great summer exploration program where we're tightening up our geochemistry and our understanding of the geology. Those results are also coming in right now. Our plan, of course, is to get out there and drill that target. Our belief is that there's potentially a second deposit on this joint venture ground position. So, again, when you look at our overall land position in Quebec, the 50,000 plus hectares at the Eau Claire region, another 15,000 hectares here, lots of fantastic geochemistry anomalies to go after, expand upon discoveries that have already been made. This just puts us in a wonderful position in Quebec to really, drive value forward here. And again, that's what our exploration programs in 2022 are going to be all about. New discoveries, expanding what we already know upon. So very excited to work with our partners on the Éléonore South joint venture moving forward. This brings us to Committee Bay. Committee Bay is in Nunavut. We're about 120 kilometers to the northeast of Agnico's Meadowbank and Amaruq deposits. We control a 300 kilometer long greenstone belt with a land position of 270,000 hectares. Again, we're unabashed saying, look, we're here to find a world-class asset, plus 5 million ounces at 7 grams. That's the vision that we have up here. We've done a lot of heavy lifting since our group has owned this particular asset. So all the belt-wide geochemistry and geophysics has been completed. Geological understanding is much more advanced than when we originally got there. From the perspective of, can you operate up here? Full camp for approximately 100 people. We own our own drill rigs. We've got fuel at site. We're in a fantastic position to get after that new discovery and to really expand upon our Three Bluffs deposit. This is a very good start. We've got about 1.3 million ounces, just shy of 8 grams per ton. And for us, we really view this as something that's going to get bigger. And I think certainly our last drill results demonstrate that that's going to be the case. So this summer we got up there. We had a reasonably small exploration program, but one that we feel was very impactful. You can see on the right-hand side of this image, the Three Bluffs deposit. We drilled a single hole in there. We had a concept we wanted to go after, and we wanted to see if it would take shape, and it certainly did. We've also drilled four holes into another prospect called Raven. We're currently waiting for the last of our results there. And then you see all these dashed blue boxes. this is places where we haven't worked before, where we really wanted to see, could we develop a target? You know, what's going to be the gold signature in the tills? These are very prospective regions from the perspectives of geochemistry and rocks that have been sampled that are high grade. And for us, this was the first opportunity to be really super active in the southwest part of the belt. So again, you know, we're excited to talk about that as those results come out in the future. However, you know, this was the news that we put out recently. What you see here is a long section of the Three Bluffs deposit located right in the middle of the belt. You know, when you look at this, the darkest colors that you see are +7 grams. That's what this deposit's all about. And we had a concept to say to ourselves, okay, if we just continue to drill out, that this thing was, we would get bigger. You know, I always said, you know, Three Bluffs goes over 2.5 million ounces if you just continue to drill at depth. But we got surprised here. You know, we were targeting a specific style of mineralization, banded iron formation, that makes up the bulk of the deposit here at Three Bluffs. And we hit something that we weren't expecting, truthfully. Nearly 14 grams of 10 meter, over 10 meters, a small gap, and then nearly 19 grams over 3 meters, another small gap, and then 23 grams over a meter. Multiple intercepts in a horizon that we weren't really anticipating would deliver like it did. It's 120 meter step out from the known resource. Beautiful result. Obviously, it's the new unit that's mineralized that's the key for us. It's in metasediments. It doesn't look as flashy as the rest of the deposit. Truthfully, as a geologist, you look at it and you go, "Eh, it looks okay. You know, there's some sulfide in there, alterations, you know, weak to moderate. Okay, fair enough." And then the results came in and we were like, this is obviously a lot more significant than we originally thought. So for us now, you can see these little dots around the intercept. This is our drill plan for next year. Obviously, we want to expand upon that. We want to see if this metasediment unit can continue to deliver like that, as it did here in this first hole. And if it does, you know, we're off to the races. You know, we're going to absolutely get after this and see if Three Bluffs itself can kind of get to that threshold that you need up in that part of the world. But certainly, you know, wonderful result to follow up on in 2022. So with all that, you know, we have to talk a little bit about you know, where the company is positioned, and what some of the catalysts are moving forward. Ultimately, we have pending drill results, which we're obviously looking forward to. You know, we've had some good success at Eau Claire, and we continue to feel like we're going to have more. Beyond that, though, there's going to be a lot of targets being generated at the Eau Claire land position. You know, that's going to be a very clear indication of where we will be exploring in 2022. Obviously, the Percy Val discovery and the expansion of that and building additional targets there are going to be critical. And then finally, you know, we very much look forward to working, to seeing how the Golden Triangle comes together with the Dolly Varden deposits, as well as the Homestake Ridge deposit. And that's obviously super key for us. At this point, we've got about 125 million shares outstanding. Another 7.4 million options out there at an average strike price of about $2. There are some warrants as well at $1.27 average price. So we're about 141 million shares fully diluted. And you can see that we trade fairly well. You know, there's volume on the stock. This is a stock that investors can buy and sell. And I think with our catalysts coming up, we're very much looking forward to, you know, bringing in new investors who can see the potential, not only at Eau Claire in Quebec and the Éléonore South joint venture, but also into Nunavut moving forward in 2022. And then of course, you know, Fury is going to be a very large holder of Dolly Varden. And we very much look forward to the exploration program there. For our investors as well moving forward. So I think that's a fairly solid overview, you know, of our company at this stage of the game. And so I'm very happy to have the questions come in.
Michael, thank you very much for handling all of that. I can't imagine what time you must have been up this morning with a rather sizable transaction happening for the company and then joining us here at Vid5. We're very much grateful for your time today.
Oh, likewise. Thanks for having me.
Excellent. Well, as always, we get the pleasure now of dancing with the audience. We have a number of questions that have been coming through. I know it's been a busy day for you, so we'll try to end as gently as we can. But let me jump right into this. Kenneth sends a question that says, how is the timeline looking for getting a mine into production?
Well, I'm assuming this is, would be at Eau Claire.
Yeah.
Listen, I think the key here is that we need to figure out how big this resource is ultimately going to be. Prior to moving ahead with the next stage of economic study, I think it's incredibly important to really understand what it is that you may be building or somebody else may be building into the future. We have a lot of exploration to do. As I said, our vision is to see this above 2 million ounces. And at that point, once we kind of get to that feeling of like, okay, that's about what it's going to look like, that's the stage that we would move forward with those economic studies. And then, of course, then you get into figuring out what your mine building timelines would be. But certainly, I'd say for the next 2 years, you can expect us to be very much focused in on the exploration and building out that resource base prior to us initiating the next stage of study. So I know that's not the perfect answer for you in that I'm not giving you a direct timeline, but I think I'm giving you more of what needs to be done to ultimately have a successful mine be built at Eau Claire in the future.
Very good. Much appreciate the realism there. Thank you for that, Michael. Next question from Adrian. When do you expect the turnaround times at Assay Labs to return perhaps to pre-pandemic levels? Is that something you can offer at this point as
Yeah. Oh, I have a Christmas wish list and that's on it. I would love to see good turnarounds from the labs, but I can tell you it's just backed up and it ultimately it's hard to do your job as an explorationist when you're waiting 70, 80 days for your results. Gold is a very fickle element and it comes and it goes and you need those assay results to make good decisions. Ultimately for us, we took a pause in drilling. We needed to see what these results would be, regroup, get a good plan moving forward, but I can't answer that question. I can only hope that sometime in 2022 the labs build their capacity out for all of us exploration companies out there.
Fair enough, Michael. Thank you for that. We do want to honor the fact that today was a very large transaction for the company, and curiosity is definitely there in the audience. Question comes forward: how did the Dolly Varden deal come together? Just give us a little bit of background there, if you could, Michael.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I think both Dolly Varden and ourselves were very well aware of each other. We're neighbors. Our deposits are extremely close to one another. And I think truthfully, both parties had done some due diligence without talking to each other over the years. I mean, of course we knew what they were doing and vice versa. And I think it just got to a point where the synergies were just obvious. And we just said to ourselves, look, as a company at Fury, where's our focus going to be? It's going to be in Quebec and it's going to be in Nunavut. And so it made sense for us to really approach them and say to them, hey guys, is there something we can do here that makes sense? I think it was just a very natural, sort of evolution of knowing each other. And we're very impressed with the Dolly Varden management team. We expect them and know that they'll do a great job with these assets moving forward. And obviously having a couple of board seats demonstrates that hey, we're here to partner with you as well, and so very much look forward to working with that group. But also know they're going to do a great job, but it's just a natural evolution. It just made sense at the end of the day.
Very good. Well, congratulations again. We do want to look at some other good news because there's been quite a bit revolving around the company. Fury announced excellent drill results last week. Michael, what does that announcement mean for Eau Claire?
I think it just demonstrates its potential and how open that resource is. At the end of the day, I just keep going back to this vision. We want to make this resource over 2 million ounces, and that I think results like we're putting out right now demonstrate that that's possible. Even the results, not only this latest round of results, but over the last year, we've demonstrated that Snake Lake is a structure that needs to be explored. We've taken those big step outs out of the Eau Claire deposit, 700 meters out to the east, and are hitting mineralization with good grade. Of course, we got to do more drilling there. So for me, these results sort of confirm in my mind the reason for our acquisition of the Eau Claire deposit originally, and I just look forward to expanding upon it in 2022.
Fantastic, Michael. Thank you for stick handling all of these questions. I appreciate that. Ron's asking here, drill budgets for Eau Claire and Committee Bay. Can you give us some insight into the coming year?
Excellent question. We are currently putting our plans together right now. I think it'd be a little bit premature for me to throw numbers out as we're currently sort of developing them. And of course, you know, we're going to need to finance that as well. So it's going to be a combination of, you know, the technical wishes of our exploration group. You know, obviously, you know, explorationists always want all the money all the time because we see a lot of great targets out there. To my mind, what you can expect from us in 2022, I'm answering this in a little bit of a roundabout fashion, but you know, expect us to continue to expand that resource base at Eau Claire. Expect us to drill at Percy Val. I think you can expect drilling at the Éléonore South joint venture. And then, of course, with these new results coming out of the Three Bluffs deposit in Nunavut, you know, we're very likely to be there as well. Market conditions, let's see how 2022 looks for us. But certainly, I don't want to put a budget out there when we haven't even internally nailed that number down yet. But I mean, in terms of plans, I think you can expect us to be very active.
Fair enough, Michael. Thank you for that. Now, I always appreciate the bold questions. Alain is asking here, Michael, he supposes that the vision of Fury is not to build a mine necessarily, but to be a prospect developer. What are your thoughts there?
Well, okay. I have a belief that the Eau Claire asset is going to develop into a takeover target. That's my opinion. You know, as a group, we're not mine builders. I'll be the first to say that. We're explorationists. We're people who create value. So, you know, I want to create that value. I want our team to create that value for our investors. And I want to see what the options truly are. Like for me, and I can speak for our company, I believe here, we just want to see what those options are moving forward. So let's get to work. Let's build a value. And then let's see what our options are down the road in the next couple of years.
Terrific. Appreciate that very much, Michael. I'd like to honor every question from different points of the conversation. And Brian's asking a question here. Can we expect to see a ramp up in investor communications moving forward with all the recent changes?
Yeah, I think, you know, obviously it's at the core of our business to communicate with our shareholders. There's no doubt about that. And, you know, Tim Clark, who's just stepped in very recently as our new CEO, is super cognizant of that. And I really do believe you're going to see, you know, an increased level of communication from us. But also, you know, we're a group that can be reached. You know, we want our investors to reach out to us, to ask us questions. You know, you can call us up. You know, we're not a company that we know where our bread gets buttered, so to speak, and it's with our investors. So, you know, I would just say to everybody who is invested in Fury, you know, feel free to reach out to us. If you do have questions, we're available.
I appreciate that, Michael. The openness is very much welcomed. And I will say again, I know it's been a busy day for you with all the news coming down the pipeline. For you to arrive and be our last featured company today is very much appreciated. I know there's a lot of good news in the company, and it inspires investors to keep an eye very closely on the ball as things move forward into the new year. So I do like to open the door if there's anything we haven't touched on or something else that comes to mind for you to share with our audience as we wrap up today.
No, I mean, I think, you know, we've had a very positive Q4, and I think we're going to take that momentum straight into Q1 of next year. Certainly from my point of view, you know, I would just say to our investors, you know, really stay tuned. You know, Q1's going to be a big quarter for us. We've got a lot of great plans for 2022. They start in Q1 at Eau Claire, and we're going to push our targets out away from the deposit because we believe there's a second discovery to be made.
Okay.
Stay tuned. It's going to be a fun 2022.
That's great, Michael. A really positive note to end our day today on the first day of our conference. So I'll wind down and say thank you very much for the time and attention you've brought to our audience today. And as always, I know our investor audience will be keeping a close eye on the company, as will we, and we'll look forward to another conversation in future VID conferences.
Thanks very much for having us.
Thank you, Michael. I appreciate the time. What a great day one of three, folks. A wonderful launch to our VID5, which is our latest conference in the Virtual Investor Day conference series. I want to thank our featured companies today. And of course, this event could not happen without the generous support of Laurentian Bank Securities. And also a thanks to our partners on board, BTV, Newsfile, Crux Investor, First Phase, and Mining Network. Now that you've seen day one, please let your friends and colleagues know that we have two more abundant days in the conference for registration. Tomorrow on day two, we welcome the following featured companies: Major Drilling, Gold Mining Incorporated, Monarch Mining, Guanajuato Silver Company, Major Precious Metals, Nighthawk Gold Corporation, Ridgeline Metals, Magnetera Minerals, and Lucky Minerals. Plus, a panel moderated by our very own sponsor, Laurentian Bank Securities, on exploration, development, and investing in Quebec. So with that tease, I will say thank you to everyone for joining us here at VID5. I'm your host, Mark Johnston, signing off and looking forward to seeing you tomorrow. Have a great night.